So the bar is extremely high now. So let's see if I can match that expectation level. Thank you all for showing up in this great venue. So pleasure to talk to you a little bit. First of all, I would be interested, so again, a show of hands, sorry, but then I won't bother you anymore. Who has already financed a company? So there's an entrepreneur who has already done a financing round. Please raise your hand. Who's planning to do this? Who is interested in working in venture capital? So on the other side of the table. Okay, so we have a good mixture. I try to cover all these aspects a little bit. First of all, so stupid question to start with, who am I? I usually avoid this, so I'm not the guy usually putting me up front, but I was asked to do so and share a lot of personal experience, so I'm trying to do so. I'm a little bit shy otherwise, but let's see if it works. Oh. I'm a serial entrepreneur myself, so I founded companies already parallel to school, so sometimes I wake up at night and think, oh my god, I need to pass this A-level exam, and then how will I do it, because I haven't been at school like half a year before or something. So the last years of Abitur in Germany for me was more or less in parallel already, 50% of the time working and doing stuff. I started with something like a very early stage multimedia company, already starting the offline part, so we created multimedia CD-ROMs with Macro Media Director and stuff like that. I don't know if anybody of you still knows that. And then there came the internet, of course, and everybody was switching like to online HTML streaming, etc. I think because we have a streaming camera here, we did like one of the first large-scale streaming things for Axel Springer back then when they started the new BDE project when Dietmann was the new managing director, who now left the company, and he was like at Springer for whatever, 15 years, so it must be some time ago. So that was interesting, that was fun, but I was kind of distracted on the way, because I needed to finance my own company, and the question was, after the friends, family, and fools money, so the 3F money was gone, how to get the first million, D-mark, euros, whatever. And so this experience for my own company kind of got me in the interaction. How is a deal like this? How is it done? Who are the investors? What do they want to see? What are they kind of investing in? How does your team need to look like? So just from my personal experience to finance my own company, I was instantly interested to learn more in that direction. So I financed my own company, but then a lot of friends back then in Munich asked me, hey, how did that work? Can you help us? Yeah, and that started to be quite interesting. So you meet a guy over lunch or dinner or whatever, and they open their mind, they tell you everything, what their plans are, also of course what the problems are. So if you have like a founder issue and you don't know if you want to have to change the team, or you already have shareholders, maybe you have missed the expectations from the first round and you're struggling now how to go to the next stage. That was very interesting. And I felt that for me, it might be more interesting kind of to switch to that part of the story. So to help people structure and finance and turn around and sell their companies instead of just focusing on one single company. Yeah, I don't know, maybe it was a plan, maybe it just was a naive idea. But at the end of the day, it turned out that it was very, very interesting because you learn a lot more per year than if you just do one company. So that's at least how I argued it. Yeah. So for me, it made sense. It was very interesting to help a lot of entrepreneurs structuring their deals, their companies, and also, of course, not only the good ones. Yeah. So I'm an expert for stuff that doesn't work out. So it's not so that the standard company is sold to Google just 5 years after financing. You all know that there are a lot of ups and downs in between. Of course, if you support founders raising money, you're kind of on the wrong side of the table. Simplistic statement. So you try to also kind of find a way to get to the other side, the investor side of the table. And I was very curious, okay, how does that work? What can we do kind of as a consulting project, a product for investors? How can we support them in sourcing the right deal? So doing due diligence and stuff like that. And I found out that this works here or there, but it's a tricky exercise because investors don't want to share too much from their management fee. So So a concept I explain later on. So consulting an investor is very difficult. Unless you're a lawyer or you're a tax advisor or something and you make a due diligence, because this is something they don't bill to their management fee account, they bill this to the investment. So they don't, the partners don't have to pay it, the fund pays for it. So that was interesting finding, but still, of course, we were kind of intrigued how to work for investors and become investors ourselves. And one product that we found was that a lot of, let's say, more serious serial business angels, so if you want to say so, super angels, end up having 20, 30 investments in parallel to what they are doing. So maybe they are full-time CEO or they are whatever, have international lifestyle, etc. So they do this as a hobby on the side. But if you have 20, 30 investments, seed stage investments maybe mainly, it's a lot of work. So it really gets hard work, and maybe this it's fun to do some business angel investments first, talk about the future, turns around a little bit and bites you, this gets frustrating. So we said, okay, let's do a product for these guys, so set up something like a family office for super business angels, and help them with exactly the same process that any VC has, so deal flow, syndication, controlling, whatever, the CFO part of it, as an outsource structure, so they can be more they can focus more on the parts they really like, so to talk with founders about the great future, whatever, but we kind of offload them with all the stupid stuff nobody wants to do. And this product was quite successful, and this is basically the core part of Corporatia. And out of that, so the story just goes on, we met with more investors, with more guys who were doing like principal investments out of their private wealth, but of course some of these people then also start with the idea, why only invest alone, why not form a syndicate, form an angel, GmbH, fund, whatever. And out of these customers, one customer was Christoph Gerlinger, and he was a serial entrepreneur himself, did two IPOs in the gaming industry, and he was, in a simple way, considering what to do next with his life. So he took his money, plus some family and friends money, and founded a German Startups Group. A German Startups Group became a customer of us, and we supported German Startups Group in raising the structure from maybe like 10 investments to currently around 50, including listing the company on the Frankfurt Stock Exchange, which of course creates a lot more red tape than just investing your own private money in your GmbH. So this is, in a nutshell, the story, and on the way to that, of course, we consulted some corporates what to do with corporate venture capital. Is it a good idea to set up the TENS accelerator for something if you're corporate, etc. So that's what we did. And last but not least, I'm currently writing a book on these, let's say, VC terms. Maybe you know Venture Deals from Brad Feld. Very good book from the United States. Unfortunately, there is nothing in Germany that's the equivalent. And I was always kind of frustrated that there is no good literature. And so I decided to write it. Of course, it's tough work if you do that in parallel, but hopefully it will be finished mid this year. And for that book, I also interviewed, I would say, roughly 20 of the most relevant investment managers and partners from VCs, company builders, and serial entrepreneurs about their view on the venture deal, the philosophy behind it. What is the fair deal? Or you will hear people talking about plain vanilla terms. What exactly is that? There's no Wikipedia definition for that. So you kind of need to research it. One word about German Startups Group. I guess most of you will have heard something about it. So the idea of German Startups Group is to create something like an index fund for the asset class of German startups. So people that are interested in getting some exposure, invest some money in kind of, let's say, what we think are the best of German startups, can just buy the German Startups Group share in stock exchange. So it's a very easy process. It's not a big contract you need to sign if you invest in a closed-ended fund. You don't end up allocating your money for 8 years. You can just buy shares and you can sell them next day. And this is kind of a portfolio. This is the status of mid last year. So you see it's a broad mixture of some of the most well-known names from the German startup ecosystem, and plus, of course, a lot of smaller, let's say, movers and shakers, like maybe, for example, Unique or Scalable Capital, the companies that have very good traction currently and are rising up from seed to early to growth stage in quite some good time. And so the idea here is not the traditional VC fund where you have a simple a simple statement like 10 shots, and you try to get a hit with every shot, and you usually don't succeed with every shot, so you might end up, let's say, like with one hit or two hit, and the rest of the portfolio is so-so. That's the traditional VC approach. That approach is much more broader, much more diversified. And we're also stage agnostic, so we're not just investing in seed stage or in early stage or in growth stage, we're doing it across the board. And we're also buying secondary shares, which is also unique. So a secondary share is a share that a business angel or a co-founder kind of already has and is selling to an investor, compared to a primary share, which is what you get when you invest in a capital increase. And so especially with later stage companies, that's also an interesting thing. And in Germany, nobody's really doing that. So it's kind of a market niche. I thought that for you, it might be interesting to hear the pitch the other way around. So what is the VC pitch? Not to the entrepreneurs, yeah? We can cover that a little bit. But what's the VC pitch to his investors? Because VCs are usually just kind of an intermediate. Yeah? They raise capital like a startup does. So they have to do pitches themselves like the entrepreneurs. And on the other hand, they reinvest that money, hopefully in a good and structured way. And so what is our pitch? So I'll show you some slides about that and some thoughts why this could be relevant. I like this chart. The blue square is the German wealth. And maybe already some of you guess what the white dot is. That's what's invested in venture capital. Yeah? And that's real. If you break it down, you see that in Germany we have something like 7 trillion euro wealth, institutional and private wealth. So it's no problem, money is there. And you see that just a small part, 80 billion euro, is invested in so-called alternative investments. These are the terms that if you go to whatever, London or Frankfurt or something, and talk to people that manage the big money, the big accounts, banks, etc., these are the terms that we use. And already the term alternative investment kind of sounds like this is the dirty niche, right? And in that niche, venture capital is again the smallest part. Yeah, so in that year it's just 1 billion or something. Maybe it's 2 billion, maybe it's 3 billion in a good year. But usually a lot is only rocket. So if you deduct rocket, you maybe end up again with 1 or 2 billion. So we're talking about a niche of a niche. Yeah? So the exposure to venture capital is really, really, really small. So on the one hand side, that's kind of bad because there is a little money in the system. On the other hand, it's a good opportunity because as an investor, if you can provide funding, you're in an interesting position. Yeah? If you have a situation like in France or in the United States, you have much more money in the system, investors will compete against each other much more often than in Germany. Yeah? So good thing for us. Of course, if we talk to investors, it might also be, let's say, very conservative ones, that we need to explain why the hell is it interesting to invest, for example, in the digital economy. Okay, it's simple, yeah? You can show a lot of numbers that go up. So ubiquitous broadband, yeah, everybody has a smartphone these days. Business models that didn't work out 5 years ago because you didn't have like the infrastructure, you can now just do it, you have the critical mass for that. And this is always an interesting chart if you show that to people managing money, for example, in big equity funds, so they can just invest in shares. Only the three biggest US startups are worth much more than the full DAX 30. Yeah? And this chart is old. It's the numbers from end of 2040. If you use current numbers, it's times 1.6 or something. Yeah? So any big money investor, yeah, thinks it's a good idea to invest in, for example, SAP. Hey, that's a software company. It's innovative, right? Well, not really. So innovation is somewhere else, and so it's very important to allocate money in these companies. So if you want to allocate money in these kind of companies, how do you do that? If you are the traditional big money guy, you can only invest in listed equities. So a company that has a share that's traded on the stock market, that's a listed equity. But if you look at the chart on the right, taking the nasty example of Vinland.de, if you invest at the IPO, valuation was, let's say, 400 million euros, you lost a lot of money, yeah, in the aftermath. I don't know where the stock price is today, hopefully it's better, but usually these guys can only invest at that point. Let's say the clever guys, the VCs invested maybe there, maybe there, maybe there. Yeah, and they took the money and maybe ran away. Yeah, if they were wise. So they created significant profit for their investors again because they invested pre-IPO. If you look at some numbers from United States, unfortunately, because you have a lot of more numbers about United States, which is a problem, but I can show you the concept there. The darker part here is the money times X profit you could create if you invested at the IPO of Apple. Yeah? So you see it's like times 400. Yeah? So calculate that for a second. So, and Dell and these kind of companies are in the same league. Yeah? So if you invested like $1,000 at IPO, you will not have any problems anymore. But you see that there is a trend that even starting with Google, which was a great IPO, the company still created a lot of upside after the IPO, and all the other companies, it was quite difficult to get this times 100 return if you just invest after the IPO. And that trend is continuing. So companies go public at a later point in time, they're more mature, and so investing in private markets, which is the opposite to public markets, is getting more and more interesting for people that want to allocate money and earn a decent return. Of course, another thing is that earning a realistic interest is getting more and more difficult in the past couple of years. So you all will know that for yourself. So to buy something which is not a crazy bet and get a 10% interest per year is almost impossible right now. And so that also leads to the interesting situation that, for example, insurance companies that sell you your life insurance and that in the good old days said you would get an interest, a guaranteed interest rate of 3% or something, are really struggling to keep their promise. Because if they allocate their money in bonds and whatever, something that is kind of secure, they don't get the interest anymore. So also they have to switch their money to the so-called alternative investments, because this is the area where you can get some money. As I said before, so depending on the statistics you look at, we are kind of far behind. So Germany is still an emerging market for venture capital. The United States will have times 10, times 8, times 13, doesn't really matter, but a lot more. And also, for example, our colleagues in France, then there is a tax incentive program that was set up some years ago. And basically, everybody who's investing, a private individual who's investing in an FCPI fund, and gets a tax deduction the year he's investing. And so everybody knows that. So if you are, whatever, let's say a dentist in the suburb of Paris, your tax advisor will say at the end of the day, invest some money in that fund because you get a tax return. So and this also led to the increase from, let's say, below the German level to above the German level. Yeah? So there are things happening. And yeah, Berlin is great, the next city, Silicon Valley, blah, blah, blah. But if you look at the scale, we still have a lot of headroom. And I was referring about the investor's pitch. So, of course, like in any investor's pitch, you will also have some things about your experienced team, and of course, it must be super experienced. You need a lot of track record, and everybody has some smart money value. So, okay, everybody will have a different approach there. So. Maybe they are like the super experts in software as a service and can coach the investors there. If you ask us, I would say, okay, we did, I don't know, hundreds of transactions, 3 IPOs, etc., so we can be supportive there. And maybe you also have, let's say, some kind of secret source USP, how you structure your investments, how you find the best deals, some analytic thing there. I don't know. Yeah, everybody has some different flavor. So very important question, if you want to work in VC, or if you are negotiating with a VC, of course it's very, very helpful if you understand where he earns his money. And if you understand the business model of your opponent in some kind of discussion, it always helps. And this ugly 80s diagram from Wikipedia shows the traditional venture capital structure. It hasn't changed over the years. It's the same in the US than in Germany. Only in Germany you would have not a limited partnership, you would have a GmbH and Co. KG. That's the only difference. But if you translate GmbH Co. KG to English, it's again limited partnership. So the so-called limited partners are the investors in the fund. And the fund manager, which is the general partner, is managing that entity. The general partner is not directly participating in the companies. So So the companies are owned by the fund, which is owned by the limited partners. But the interesting thing is this relation here. So there is a management contract where the general partners will get the so-called management fee, which is typically something like 2% or 2.5% per year of the money that's in the fund. Yeah, so simple math, 100 million in there, 2 million, 2.5 million to pay salaries, rent, travel, etc. And the upside is the so-called carried interest. And the carried interest is something like a profit share. So the usual structure would be the limited partners are investing 100 million in the fund. The general partner is managing that money, is doing whatever, 10, 20 investments. In the first 3 to 4 years, that would be the usual cycle. And then the next 3 to 4 to 5 years, you try to sell off, to grow the companies and sell them off. So the money comes back. Let's say 100 million goes in, 200 million come back, so you have 100 million profit. And out of this 100 million profit, the managers get 20%. That's the business model. So 20% from 100 million is 20 million, sounds interesting. Yeah, if you're 2 or 3 partners, that's a lot of cash. And of course, there might be some tricks here or there. There might be a hurdle rate, for example. So the investors first get back, for example, 8% per annum interest on the money they invested. And so the bar is higher for the profit share. And so it's starting after the hurdle rate. Yeah, but still, this is what anybody who's working in venture capital, besides making the world a better place, of course, wants to do. Earn part of the capital. And so if you're thinking about working in venture capital, besides making the world a better place, the question is how to get a part of the carry at the end of the day. So the usual structure is that any venture capitalist can attract brilliant guys and girls and minds, etc., because everybody wants to work in that industry. And there are just a limited number of kind of seats available for you. So you get very, very good CVs, very good people applying for a job, even just an apprenticeship. And so usually you have to enter the venture capital world kind of on the low end. Yeah, you earn for 1 to 3 years, you won't earn a lot of money. And then maybe you upgrade, let's say, to a standard salary, but that's still the interesting thing. You need to be there, for example, when a new fund generation is structured and raised, and you then get a partner of that fund. And that maybe happens after, I don't know, let's say 5 years, 2 years, 10 years, or it doesn't happen at all. So you see a lot of people in the industry dropping out of existing venture fund managers for that very reason, because they are kind of hitting the ceiling. Yeah, they cannot get partner in that structure because maybe the existing partners don't want to share the carry. So these people then create a new fund, maybe, yeah, join up 2-3 guys. But as said before, you need to have some kind of track record for that. So to raise a fund, you need to have the experience of having raised a fund. Yeah, so you see, it's a tricky thing. So you must be there, do some good deals, grow up, and then there must be a good opportunity to also join the partnership. So how to spend the money in hopefully a wise way. Any VC can show you a chart like that. So this is the deal flow from 2015. And I think 2016, just the numbers are higher, but the ratio is similar. So you get a lot of proposals. I would personally say maybe currently it's around 1,000. And you have to sort them out in this final process, because it's totally impossible to meet with 1,000 teams or to discuss terms. So you need to find kind of a mechanism merged with a good, clever gut feeling, and that you're not passing on the really good ones, but you're passing on the bad ones. And that you spend your time, you focus your time on the good ones. So that's let's say, the magic in the first things here. And, of course, any investor will have some certain investment criteria. So maybe he just invests in C-Stage. Maybe he just invests in whatever, software as a service or e-commerce or whatsoever. So that's simple. But, for example, we are stage agnostic. We invest all digital business models, B2C, B2B, even a little bit of hardware. So we must focus on, let's say, these other more softer factors, which in our case are mainly serial entrepreneurs, so the track record of the team. So that's the deal we want to do that we will do most likely if the co-founder of Delivery Hero, for example, sets up a new company, something like that. So these are the things that are really getting our attention. And of course, we'll have some other stuff like there must be some high scalability, innovation, and so on. Yeah. But at the end of the day, quality of the team, quality of the setup, also quality of the co-investors matters most. I will just very quickly jump over that. If you are interested in deal terms, and there is a three-hour YouTube video online called Venture Capital Masterclass. So that was something I did the other day, and you can watch there. There you'll have 120 pages PowerPoint that cover that in more detail. So I just quickly touch on that. So one of the main questions when you create a deal, when you make a deal, is of course, what's the correct valuation? What's the fair valuation? Yeah, how to do that? So the venture capitalist will look at it by doing kind of a backwards calculation. If he is investing in seed stage, where maybe, if he's clever, he has a failure rate of 50%, he needs to get 10 times potential of getting his money back, otherwise he cannot invest. Because if you just multiply these numbers, you end up with something like 40% of IRR per year, 40% of performance profit generated per year. And this is roughly the gross profit the venture capital needs from an early stage company. Because then he has to deduct management fee and lawyers and stuff. And so maybe then after the carry, the net IRR for his investors is maybe 20-25% per year. And this is roughly what he has sold his investors. So if you don't have this times 10 potential, maybe you still have a great company. Yeah, no problem. But this is what you were referring about capitalism. So if you have a slower growth perspective, the investor just cannot invest, because his money is not fitting your proposal. Still, you can do a great company. Of course, if you're looking at early stage or growth stage, let's say the assumed total default rate goes down, so the upside can be smaller. Yeah, it's totally fair to invest in a late stage company where you maybe just get 2 times or 3 times your money back as an upside. And because you assume that the chances that the company, for example, let's say Mr. Specs, that they go completely belly up, that the chances are very small. So you don't need to see the larger upside there. Of course, there is fine print. Yeah, valuation is not just that number. So that's a very important thing. So for example, liquidation preferences is if you get the number, if you get the money once, or there are kind of milestones in the deal where you end up being in danger that the investor gets 100% of the shares but pays 50% of the money. Dangerous thing. There can be other dilutive things, etc. And so usually we just say, okay, in a fair deal, these elements shouldn't worry too much. And it's very important to not just focus on the number. Yeah, so it's kind of a little bit overrated. Of course, any investor wants to see that the founder has a serious focus on what he's doing. I always say that there's nothing as a parallel entrepreneur. It's called serial entrepreneur for a reason. So if you present, like, if you go to an investor and have your bouquet of flowers with 10 different things, very, very, very strange pitch. So the investor wants to see that you're focused. Even with most business angels, founder vesting is getting a standard. So the business angels, at least the ones I talk to or have worked with, are getting more professional there, and they want to see that, especially if you have a founder team, if you have 2-3 people founding a company, that they also protect themselves inside the team by implementing a serious founder vesting, so that if one leaves out of the 3 in year 2 or something, his shares are kind of going back to the company, at least a part of it. And the other part is no surprises. So if you talk to any VC, so if you have this relation that's been built up, it's always kind of an assessment center. So there's always the dimension what you're talking about, but there's also the dimension how you're talking, how the interaction is happening. And will you put problems on the table early on in the process? Yeah, usually first-time founders are kind of afraid to do so, But VCs are used to working with problems. That's kind of their business. So they need to assess the problems. They need to sort it out. They need to see if it's a showstopper or if it can be worked on. But if something pops up in the last part of the process, the trust relationship will be gone. There is always some discussions about information rights, but this is something where I always advise to not discuss about it. So any VC needs data. So they again have their own investors. They need to report. So if they get proper data from you, you need to set it up once. It might be some work, but just do it. Don't argue about it. Just do it. Do it in a proper way. A lot of teams lose the relationship with their VCs because laziness in reporting. Because for you as the entrepreneur, it just might be a total waste of time. Maybe you feel like that. And usual emails are then, I want me to do sales and hire 10 great people and whatever, or you want me to do stupid reportings? Yeah, of course, maybe driving sales is more important for the company to flourish. But the VC and also VC is not just one partner, it's the whole organization, it's their back office, it's their CFO, it's their LPs. They need this data, and if you don't provide it, you might create problems that you don't need. Of course, there's tons of discussion about VCs that want to have control. Reality is VCs don't want to have control. A good VC, let's say a good one, doesn't want to be even maybe next to you on the driver's seat. So you're in the driver's seat. He doesn't even want to sit in front. He wants to sit in the back. You're driving the car. You're doing it. Yeah. I personally always say, I don't want to invest in a team. I need to coach. Yeah, I don't have the time. I don't consider myself to be more clever than you are in your domain. I want to find the best teams that can do it themselves. So this is why at the end of the day, there will always be some kind of thresholds for, let's say, board or shareholder authorizations. So the managing directors are running the business. And they can do a lot until they hit a certain barrier where it really gets exceptional. So where you hire somebody, whatever, above 100K salary in a seed-stage company, so nothing that you do like every week. Or you have a budget, and you say, this budget is approved. Everything that's in the budget, you don't need to go to your shareholders anymore. But if there is some outstanding things, of course, the shareholders want to have a vote or discuss with you. Of course, the transferability of shares will be restricted. So it's still the idea that the investor will get out his money before the founders. That's a core principle. If the founders sell off their shares and leave the investor kind of in the empty company, he has a big, big problem. So he will always be very focused on that aspect, that the founders in general are not able to sell their shares without an exit process where the investors also sell their shares. These things get more, let's say, flexible if you are a growth stage company. If you are the CEO of a growth stage company, if you have proven that the system works, if you are near, let's say, a company value of 50 million, 100 million, something like that, it is no problem that also the founders sell off some of their shares to get some cash in. So the good investor will say, okay, you have worked very hard, you have paid a very low salary for a lot of years, now you have a family, you want to buy your first house or something, no problem, take some money off the table. But of course, at first, so if you enter the discussion with the VC and you ask him for money, not for your company, but for yourself or for some other shareholders that left the company, that's of course a bad thing to start any discussion. A very important part is, let's say, the logistics. Things get more complicated tremendously if you have more people in the cap table. And that happens. Yeah. So after any financing round is before any financing round. So you're not just raising capital once, usually. So maybe you end up with having 20, 30, 50, 100 people in your cap table, in your documents. You must find mechanisms how to organize that. That if you are in a funding situation, and you even have investors, so the biggest thing is that you need to go to the notary and you need to have signatures from 100 people. Yeah, maybe the deal will be delayed or can even break up because one of the shareholders who's officially on the Cayman Islands or whatever is not giving a signature. So you need to find pooling mechanisms, trust mechanisms, etc. And very important, no single shareholder should ever have a veto position in any of your documents. A good document will always read something like, for this measure, you need an investor majority vote. Yeah? It doesn't say that investor A, investor B, and investor C have explicitly to agree. It's always majorities, also between the investors. Because if you don't have that, and this happens, it's not something that's just academic. If you don't have this in place, and if you're near an exit, it might be that a shareholder who invested 50K 5 years ago now sees this as the final opportunity to optimize the part he gets from the exit proceeds. Because just from the contracts, maybe he just gets, whatever, 500K, which is a good return, but he needs to sign something, and he sees that he is in a blocking position for the process. So maybe he just says, yeah, maybe I get 500K, but I read the contract in a different way, and I get 1 million. So what do you do? And it happens that in these situations, then shareholders get more money than they should get because these structures, these blocking positions are not cleared before that. I'm coming to the last topic because I didn't want to only tell you about, let's say, the technical part. I also want to tell you a little bit why I personally believe that all this venture game, now we're coming a little bit to a better world, is very important. Just besides, it's a good job and interesting to earn money. Let me start this way. Entrepreneurship or venture culture, as I said it here, the core belief is that people consider change as an opportunity. And if you look around, that hasn't been more relevant than today to really emphasize that and to be positive about change. Because just giving you some examples, a lot of international movements are now steering in the opposite direction. I was interviewed something like 10 times from different media about the impact of Brexit. Of course, everybody wants to hear, yeah, Berlin is the winner and stuff. But the real answer, of course, is that for a startup in London, Brexit is a disaster for several reasons. Today, a Berlin-based startup has 30 to 40% international talent in from day one, which is a great thing. I think like 5, 6, 7 years ago, the typical German startup was just, let's say, Germans. And with the international talent also going global, it's something that it's natural, it's in the DNA. Yeah, so always, for example, the Swedish guy knew that he has to create an international company because in Sweden he has, what, like 8 million households or something, so building a global company is relevant from day one. Germans were a little bit lazy because we have that big domestic market. Yeah, but now companies can go global, especially, of course, in the internet age, and they need this international DNA. And in Berlin, it's already, let's say, in the last years, it's much easier to integrate international talent in your company thanks to structures like the blue card process than, for example, in Silicon Valley. One of the main reasons why Mark Zuckerberg and co. started to go kind of into politics is attracting international talent, which is already in the Obama age, very difficult in the United States, so we have an advantage here. And of course, in UK now, it's totally unclear what happens in the future with international talent. But the problems don't stop in UK. So we have right-wing movements all around the place. And some years ago, if you had like Wilders in Holland or something, yeah, the Germans were saying like, oh, it's just in these countries something happening. But it's happening all around the place. Yeah, so think about the AfD movement and what their agenda is. What's the common denominator? All these people consider change as coming directly out of hell. And this is the opposite to entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is about approaching change as something positive, yeah? Doing something, creating something. And of course, the list goes on. We talk about situation in the United States. I would personally say that already some years ago, maybe starting with the Bush administration, the glorified picture that the United States are the holy grail for all entrepreneurs started to kind of crumble. And of course, today, do you really consider that United States is the thing where you want to go as an entrepreneur? Yeah, okay, California, etc. They're kind of struggling against the movement, but let's see how that works out. So that's a really, really tricky situation. And in that environment, and this is a global phenomenon, I'm a true believer that more than ever, entrepreneurship is kind of the opposite movement against that. Yeah. So entrepreneurship is about the positive parts of change. It's about international culture, international people, diversity, etc. And so more than ever, I think this is the change the world part that we all need to join, and where we all have a common agenda. It doesn't matter if you're a founder, or if you're a VC, or if you're in education in that area. So I think that we can really do something even just beyond building great companies and earning decent money. So if you're not already joined that, please join, found a company, go to VC. I think that's the best decision you can do in your life. Thanks a lot. I think you all know about the term of impact investing, for example. So impact investing applies the, let's say, numbers-driven methodology of venture capital investing to charity, kind of best of both worlds. Yeah. And usually, let's say, the LP in a venture fund, high net worth individual, has different tranches where he invests. And we will have some venture capital, he might have some let's say, more impact-oriented stuff, or streams in charity. But 80 to 90% of his wealth go into, let's say, stupid asset classes. Yeah, just buying Siemens shares, just buying, I don't know, the 125th house somewhere. That was also driving prices. So I think that the realistic goal that we all can have and join forces in is that the percentage of money that goes to that asset class, as I described with the pie charts, is increasing, yeah, because it's still such a tiny fragment. And I think we can all agree on, if we get more percentage of money in there, there will be also society value, yeah, because we create innovation, we create jobs, etc. And so for example, whatever, just think about the situation in the automotive sector. Yeah. So some years ago, everybody was laughing about the idea that a startup can build a full car and roll it out internationally. Yeah, and right now, so the industry is really running behind a startup like Tesla. So I think there is a value just beyond creating, earning money, and that people that have money and invest in there want to have an interest on that. You can have a discussion about that, okay, yeah? But I still believe that if they invest in startups, they create also more value beyond just the economic value that they earn, the return they earn, than if they just invest in, let's say, stupid asset classes.
Any other questions?
I have one question. What's the average return that these are offering to investors here in Germany?
Yeah. Of course it depends. The best statistics around are from the European Investment Fund, the EIF, because they are invested in, I don't know, 280 European VCs. Yeah? So they are kind of fund investor. And they provide some numbers how their average return is from their investments in VCs. So that's the best data you can get. And out of my head, I would say that the average return they have from all these investments is net 6%, which doesn't sound so good, but the top quartile creates something like 25% and up. So the question is always not just to invest in some VC, yeah, but it's always the battle how to invest the best, how to identify the best VC managers. So everybody, any VC wants to be the top quartile VC, yeah, with 20-something plus. And there are some fabulous funds in the United States that both invested in Facebook and Google and whatsoever. They had maybe 45, 50, 60% return, but that's not the norm. Yeah? So the norm will be, if you are above 10%, I would say it's an interesting product because it's a low interest environment currently. If you are above 20%, it's really good performing VC fund for Germany or for Europe. It's a little bit, it may be a little bit higher, but I think if you would have such a broad sample and not just consider Kleiner Perkins and Sequoia and whatever, I don't think that it would be much higher. But the problem is getting data. Yeah, there is not so much public data available than with stock market listed companies, for example. Yeah, so you can easily just look it up on the internet. But this IIF data, so. This 5% overall, that was not there all the time. So if you look at the numbers from 5, 6, 7 years ago, the asset class of venture capital maybe was earning like 0% or 1%. So it has gone up, which is also why you will see more new fund managers around. Yeah? So the venture asset class in total is performing better. So if people that have good, clever pitch and a good track record, like, I don't know, let's say the Cherry Venture guys, etc., etc., when you fund, currently it's a good environment to raise new funds. Yeah.
It does sort of sound like a lottery, though. I mean, if you're taking the funded funds, the European funded view, the example you gave, so they have an average return of 6,
yeah,
of which the top quartile is 25, then everything else is going to be, you know, like nothing or minus or something like that in order to get that down to an average of 6. So you look at it and you say if you've got 100, it's like those notices you see on the lotto tickets. Your chance of winning this is like 1 million against,
yeah,
it or something. That's not quite that bad, but it does clearly demonstrate that a small number of things are going to be successful and a big number of them are not going to pan out.
Right. So, of course, as always, you have to see how you compare it. What is your benchmark? And if your benchmark is, for example, an investment in the DAX index or something like that, you can easily say if this asset class outperformed the benchmark over the last, whatever, 10, 20 years or not. And I would generally say so that VC in Europe is at least on par, yeah, or in some areas outperforming. So it's difficult to say if 6% is good or bad. Yeah? It also depends on the vintage, on the time you're in. But the other thing is, I would not say it's lottery. Lottery is just luck. Yeah. So there is no system how to optimize your chances in a lottery. But for example, if you're a poker player, and if you're a really good player, and you play 100 games, it will show that you're a good player. If you just play 10 games, maybe it's just luck. So I think you can improve chances, you can make not just guesses, you can make educated guesses, you can optimize it. But as the name venture capital says, so there's always venture, so risk inside. Yeah, it's about managing the risks and making the educated bets, not just the bet. So, of course, it's true that if you look at investors from Germany, you will rarely find even a single Series C, Series D growth investor. So, all the growth companies that we have in the portfolio, if they raise, I don't know, let's say 30 million, 40 million in a round, 80% of the money will come from Anglo-American investors. Maybe some French ones, but not a single German fund. Because the largest German VC funds, which is currently, I would say, Lakestar, Holzbrink, They are in the range of 250 up to 300 million. So just if you say a simple calculation, they need to invest in 10, 12, 15 companies to get their risk diversified. The largest check they can write is maybe 20 million. And also maybe they don't want to allocate all that money in one deal, so maybe they invest 10 million, then keep some dry powder to invest later on. So as we don't have the super funds, so there's not a single VC fund with 500 million plus in Germany, if you need more money, you have to go abroad. Good news is that works. So all the companies like Specs, etc., were able to attract British, Scottish, United States-based investors, and these investors like to fly in to Berlin or to Germany because the market is very interesting for them. It's undervalued compared to the United States. It's cheap to invest here. The quality of the companies, the quality of the framework is very high, so they don't see a big difference to the Silicon Valley there. We have a low tax environment. It's legal situation is very straightforward in Germany. It's even easier than the United States sometimes. So it's a good place to invest. So international money is coming in. It's possible. Would it be good for the ecosystem if we have some Series C, some senior investors on the ground? Definitely. But I think it's oversimplified to say that the reason for insolvencies is that. Because 95% of the insolvencies will happen before that stage. Yeah. So insolvencies happen in the first 1 to 3 years, basically because there is no, let's say, product market fit, or however you want to call it, that you can create, and investors don't see a proof of concept, and so they're not willing to invest more money, or even there is kind of a breakup situation, the team or whatever, other kind of stuff. And that happens usually in the early years of the cycle, and not in year 5 or 6 when you're doing the Series D or E.
You mentioning the
So there is an ongoing trend that any corporate needs to do something with startups. Yeah. Also, for example, just speaking of this institution, yeah. So a lot of old corporates are on the wall down there. They want to be innovative. Yeah. And so, is that a good thing? Yeah. Why not? But of course, you have to zoom in. Yeah. So if a little bit over exaggerated, but if a boring corporate is setting up the next corporate accelerator, which kind of people, which quality of deal flow will they attract? Speaking of corporate venture funds, of course, let's say the independent funds will always be kind of a little bit skeptic that the corporate venture investors share the same agenda, because you're a strategic investor at the end of the day. You have some added thoughts why you're doing the investment. You maybe want to have some special rights in the contracts. You maybe want to buy the company later on. And the rest of the cap table doesn't want that. You don't want to have Poseidon in your cap table and then sell the company to Bertelsmann. That might be impossible. So it might be a poison pill in the structure. So there are some hurdles there. And the second part is spending money is very, very easy. It makes fun. It's cool. Yeah? But for any corporate to create value beyond the financial return, this is why they do corporate venture capital, is a very tough exercise. If you buy the company at the end, what you wanted to have, the agile entrepreneurship thing, is gone after 1-2 years when the founders have left the company, when they're out of the earn out, when the gold handcuffs are gone. Right? So you have to find a structure how you create kind of an evergreen partnership between a corporate and entrepreneur at the end of the day, something that, for example, Axel Springer is now optimizing. So they leave 20% of the shares with the founders. They don't buy 100% of the company. They kind of want to create then a profitable evergreen. Everybody gets some dividends out of that, for example. So I think, yeah, a lot of corporates are going into there. It's why not? Yeah, so more options for entrepreneurs to get money from. But have a closer look if there are some strings attached. And corporates have to learn a lot how to structure it that it really makes sense for them at the end of the day.
What would be your suggestion when startups should go out to a VC fund, and when it should go out to an equity fund? responded to people about other companies.
Yeah. Good question. Of course, let's say the traditionalists will say that only the companies go to a crowdfunding site that don't get real VC, right? And I think that's partly true. And partly the reason for that is that the business model of the crowdfunding platforms is it's an agent model, it's a makler model. They get a cut of the money they raise. And if it doesn't work out at the end of the day, it might be bad public relations, but still they got their money. So the VCs get the money if their investors get the money from the exit. So it's much more alignment of interest. So this is why there is kind of currently, let's say, with the first generation of crowdfunding platforms, there is kind of a flaw in the business model, which is kind of restricting the alignment of interest. But maybe that's changing. Yeah? We also see that the United States has much more, let's say, digital funding syndication platforms, like AngelList, etc. So it's not just traditional crowdfunding. Let's say on a positive side, of course, there are also good things about crowd financing or crowdfunding. You can generate a lot of public relations for your company, and you even get paid for it. Yeah? You don't have to pay for it. You can generate first customers. Yeah? So if you have maybe a consumer product where that is an added value, try it. Yeah, but you have to be aware that currently, if you are a crowdfunded company, there might be some negative things attached from the structure or just from how people look at your company. Yeah, it's not a positive sign that you're a crowdfunded company. That's like the inverse of the negative portfolio, any VC, and anybody can tell you some stories. I mean, I shy away from that and ask the question with an anecdote I heard from one of our investors who set up venture funds like 10 years before, and he had the opportunity to invest in what became WhatsApp, and the valuation was, I don't know, 10 million or something. They could have owned like 10%, 20% of their company for a small ticket. But they were kind of going for it at, let's say, a very German way. So wanted to have a very structured, very thick contract, etc. And then just the founder said, oh no, we're taking the money from somewhere else. Don't need to that hassle. And so they just missed that opportunity. Yeah. So, of course, these super, super unicorn exits always almost happen in the United States. Yeah. So in Germany, yeah, we have a handful of unicorns. And in some, we're at least one, we're invested. But as we are not on the market for 50 years already, it's difficult to say if, whatever. So we have not invested in, just any example, in number 26, for example. We haven't invested in there. So is that one of the future unicorns? Don't know yet. Let's see. And what you always have to consider, so if you think about unicorns from the outside, you might just see a company, a logo, and a big valuation, but you don't know really what the terms were. We might have not invested because the valuation was already high, because other terms were negative for us, because we didn't believe in the times X upside we create that we get. So it's not just, even if it's, if you miss a unicorn, it might have been a good idea to miss it, because the terms would have been better for us, or whatever. Good question?
Yeah, would you recommend that someone may
but then kind of going back to serial entrepreneur, so just
right.
I personally think that is an excellent thing if you understand the story from both sides, or even like from the three sides, yeah? So the LPs, the GP, and the founder perspective. So the more, it's always kind of the same thing you look at, but from different angles. And your picture will always get kind of clearer, you will be more, whatever, you have more data points, yeah, to decide or to think about how to negotiate, etc., if you understand the structure from all the different angles. So yes, it's definitely a good thing. And so you always see, also see people like that, the serial entrepreneurs that just sold off their company, that kind of go to even something like a senior apprenticeship to Union Square for some months, yeah? So join these companies, get inspired from the deal flow, yeah? Learn about what's hot there. So I think there's always a good thing. All done? So of course, you always get asked these questions. So what's the next big thing? Or what are you currently looking into? And my usual answer will be great teams building great companies. Sorry, stupid answer, but that's reality. Especially with our broad investment focus, we are not so much looking at the crystal ball and say, I don't know, Internet of Things 3.0 meets drones, meets AI, meets something is the next big thing. No, we just take a look at the teams, what they're doing. And so. There are waves kind of coming in, yeah. So there were still are a lot of fintech pitches around, and so you, if you are kind of agnostic to the exact vertical you're investing in, you will end up doing some fintech deals. I also think that this is not the worst area to be in there because you have all the incumbent players, the traditional banking insurance companies that are still cash rich. And that are being disrupted very hard right now, and they are buying into these startups already now. So we see the first wave of exits coming. Yeah. So this is why I would personally say, if you right now think about what you do in the next 3 to 4 years, maybe this fintech wave is already on the downside a little bit, yeah, because we see the first exits and the first strategic investors coming. Maybe not, yeah. So there will be like fintech 2.0, yeah, but. Just giving an example, so a company that were invested, Scalable Capital, the former co-CEO of Westwing, and two former executives from Goldman Sachs, so kind of perfect combination, plus the best professor around for doing the algorithms about efficient investing and risk management. They joined forces, they founded a robo-advisor. We had four pitches, it's kind of the identical topic on the table in parallel, yeah? And so for us, of course, it's an interesting situation. We can kind of match and compare. And in that scenario, it was basically the decision that this is the best team because it combines best of three worlds, yeah? The academic perspective, the banking, private banking perspective, and the online experience. And we are not regretting that investment. So they have very good traction. They're disrupting private wealth management, private banking. The product they offer, and I'm also a customer myself, also our company is a customer, so because if you have cash on the bank will tell you they charge 1% negative interest, so you have to move it somewhere, and they are investing that in ETFs in a very efficient way. Risk management is fine, so on the day of Brexit, I didn't lose a cent. If I look at my private stock portfolio, I lost whatever. So it's a good product, it works, there are quite customers, numbers going up, great, great investment. And of course, sooner or later, one of the traditional banks, wealth managers, etc., will just buy the company. They have to, they need to. Yeah, it's the new consumer interface, they are cut off, the new generation. This is the thing with N26, yeah? So if you are a customer there once, you will never again, maybe you need one or more 2 years to optimize a little bit, yes, and take out some glitches. But if you use that bank as an app on your iPhone, you will even don't think about going to a traditional retail bank to open an account. You just don't need it. There's no reason. It doesn't give you any benefit. Maybe if you're the super rich individual and need a very, very complex product, but if you're the average Joe and just want to have an account where you get your salaries sent to and you can transfer money from here to there, yeah, just with the app, hey, it's a great product. Yeah, so the banks must be very afraid. And so if you see programs like Deutsche Bank, for example, announced we now have €1 billion to do something around startups, okay, welcome. So my personal guess is that they now spend €200 million on stupid stuff like sponsoring all the events around, yeah, and then with the remaining €800 million they will just buy startups because that's the only process they can do, acquire startups at the end of the day. Okay, good for the ecosystem. Because people believe that not the best companies go to these platforms. Difficult to tell. What are the statistics? Yeah. But the problem is that, let's say, a venture capitalist that gets money personally when he's investing would be able to raise funds. He is just raising funds with a promise that he earns money when the investors earn money themselves. So there's the complete alignment of interest. And this is why I said it's a makler geschäftsmodell. Yeah, it's like the property makler that just sells you the flat. It doesn't matter if you're happy with it, more or less, as long as you pay the bill, right? And so this is why I think that like the next generation of business models there will have more quality control, will have more alignment of interest. And then these things go away. So still, I think that we are in an environment where we have, let's say, too little entrepreneurial funding. So it's good that there are new models. And if you talk about fintech, yeah, of course, what is the fintech VC vertical? Yeah, we can talk about retail banking fintech. We can talk about whatever fixed interest models, we can talk about robo advisors, but who is kind of disrupting the VC business model? Yeah, with fintech, direct sales, cut out the middleman. Yeah, so it could be crowdfunding. So I'm not too pessimistic about the topic. I think it's a good thing, but I think that we now have the first years, the first experiences, and now it needs to evolve to like version 2.
Well, version 2. Thank you very much, Nikolas.
Thanks for having me.